Hey guys, so as I mentioned during the previous topic, previous episode, we will be doing a post-mortem of how to get to MotoGP. You know, we'll try and understand, you know, explain to you that how do you get to MotoGP, because predominantly everybody who comes to us, you know, for inquiry or, you know, for when they're sharing their aspiration and saying what you want to become, everybody says, I want to be a MotoGP rider. It's quite interesting and quite, you know, you're happy to see that so many people are interested in MotoGP. But the question is, do they understand what MotoGP is? And, you know, do they understand what it takes to become a MotoGP rider and, you know, and the path to MotoGP? Because many of them have the aspiration and the dream without knowing what exactly it is, you know. So that's one key concern, because based on my interaction with those who have come and, you know, have trained with us, have come in with a perception saying that that we want to be MotoGP riders, but absolutely don't know what motorcycle racing is, and, you know, let alone MotoGP. So to explain to you guys and to share again my experience, we try to do this without any support, help, and without any idea of what MotoGP World Championship was, and we tried to enter MotoGP World Championship in 2011. Although it was a great step and a great feat, and, you know, we had an Indian rider who rode for three races, and then we had to replace him due to you know, financial crunches with a Norwegian rider. However, the team continued for the full season, but we did experience what this whole MotoGP circus is. MotoGP is not what you know of. What you see and what you know is from a fans' perspective. It's brilliant from a fans' perspective. It's, I think, one of the best telecasted or, you know, telecasted sport, and people enjoy it the most. And, you know, the best telecast and best programming, best programmed show on earth. But having said that, to be on the participating side, it's a quite a difficult task, and, you know, it's a quite a steep ambition. You know, you have to really have the guts to make the move. At specifically, if you are from any part of Asian country, or specifically if you are from India, I'm going to talk from more from a Indian perspective, but it can apply for anybody from any part of the world in the, you know, Asian Oceanic region also, because predominantly MotoGP is centric and most popular in the European nations, and, you know, not even in the US, but in the European nation. US is still, you know, somewhere in between. So I have put together a few slides to explain to you how to approach MotoGP. Before that, but I will take you through the experience of how we went to MotoGP. That will also give you some idea. So let me first tell you, in 2010, you know, I got this strange mail, you know, after we won the national championship in 2010. That was the first year of national championship as a team. And we got this mail from a team saying, hey, they Googled us, browsed about, you know, racing teams in India, and I don't know why they came to me, because we are pretty naive and pretty new to the sport. And they came and said, hey, let's partner together to, you know, start a, get your rider in the world championship. And, you know, that time our champion rider was Sharad Kumar, and absolutely no knowledge about the MotoGP bikes or the MotoGP business for me also. I didn't understand the structure of it, how it is organized. But yeah, I did do my research before I put the pen to the paper and agreed in 2010. I still remember, I think many of them who were present on that day will still remember, it was on 10th October 2010, when we agreed upon principally to participate in the 2011 season of the 125 World Championship. The experience was quite surreal, in terms of to be in the paddock where you have watched all your life, you watched races on television, and to be part of that paddock was a great feeling. So that's what kicked in and made me work. Specifically, I put in a lot of effort to raise the funds and to get to that particular platform. It was a big risk. Yeah, Jabba, you were there, I remember. I still have the photographs with me. So that's how it started, but absolutely zero idea about what World Championship was, then of course we had to trust, believe the people who we were partnered with. It was a team called WTR, good gentleman from Italy, and a good friend till now. We are still in touch with each other. But the dynamics of this sport in Europe, trust me, it is nowhere near what you guys know of what it is in India. And for people who don't know what this sport is in India, it's a very, very far-fetched shot for them to, understand what this sport is all about. And forget, to get into the level of MotoGP. So when we went there, we understood, the first thing I understood, as a philosophy, what you see in the front. I keep telling this to many people who I have this conversation about the sport itself. What you see in the front, the facade of the sport, the glamour of the sport, what you see to what is there at the backside is very, very, very different. I mean, I'm not saying it's good or bad, but I would say it is quite professional, quite serious. Okay, it's not the like the glamour just fades away as you walk from the front of the pit to the back of the paddock. The pressure, the situations that we handle, the kind of financial discussions and business interactions that happen, it's far, far, far very serious. I mean, we know only MotoGP. You think riders come, riders get into the get on the bike, get into the pit, get on the bike, get out of the pit, and race, and yeah, hey, everything is done. They go home with a trophy. No, there is so much that happens behind the paddock. I would say every race event, I think there would be millions of business that happen, business deals, I mean, are signed at the paddock level. There is a culture of entertaining dealers and distributors and manufacturers coming in with their launches. It's not necessarily motorcycle, could be components, parts, riding gears, helmets. So the collaboration and the kind of interaction that happens there is crazy. And that's why MotoGP is so serious, and that's why MotoGP is so powerful and so big, Cheers. Now, why do people every time say MotoGP? And that's when I understood people think that MotoGP is the sport to be in, to get the kind of energy and the kind of competition, the racing and the glamour that has it, and the way it is produced. When I say produced as a television package, as a entertainment package, the way it is produced, it's unbelievable, and that's why MotoGP is so exciting for everybody to be everybody wants to be a part of MotoGP. So why everybody says MotoGP, whoever wants to race? So the mindset is, if I know to ride a bike or ride a motorcycle, people think that yes, they can ride a MotoGP bike also. That's not the case. I mean, there is a I wouldn't say it's not possible, but yeah, to ride at a competitive level and a competitive mindset at that level is totally a different factor. Everybody talks always about one factor is the money part, right? I believe that money can also be raised for MotoGP, and but the mindset that a rider, a team, a competitiveness that one has to have, the technicians, the whole package that needs to be put together is far, far, far more difficult. I would say it needs to be much more stronger in terms of there are teams that struggle for for a meal also. There are teams, I mean, I don't know now, but there were teams that who struggle for a meal, who skip a meal just to save some money for the next race. You know, that's in Europe. I mean, that's how much it costs and that's how much it means to them. You know, they've put together these teams with a lot of hardship and work, you know. So when people say I want to go to MotoGP, the only issue is that they do not understand the complexity involved in that sport. You know, they only see the concept of riding a motorcycle, but they don't see the complexity that is involved in a sport such as MotoGP as a business, right? So predominantly most of us think that, you know, it is a natural and organic growth that one has to have. If I'm talented, if I'm a rider, then I have to organically grow into MotoGP, into a system. It's not studying in first standard to 12th grade, you know, you just automatically pass and go on. Yeah, there are many things that go into it. There is effort, there is determination, there is dedication, you know. There are many things that go into it before someone gets there. And money, then you ask me, sir, money is not important. Money still, I'm telling you, can be put together for MotoGP. But if you have the correct mindset. So let me first give you an introduction of what MotoGP is, right? We all know MotoGP as a sport, right? Let's look at it from a slightly different perspective. Let's look at it from what MotoGP means to the organizer itself. Let's understand what MotoGP means, what I said behind the paddock, right? If someone has to look at MotoGP, they have to understand that bit of it and that part of it, that side of it, to, you know, even attempt to say I want to be a MotoGP rider. So quickly, I'll start putting some slides for you guys, and I will be talking, maybe my video won't be available, but the slides will be active, and you can hear my voice. So let me put the first slide to explain what MotoGP is, you know. So this is for people who don't know, who think MotoGP is a sport like Olympics where I want to go participate. Yes, it is a sport, it is a competitive environment. I hope everybody can see this. Give me a wave and thumbs up if everybody can see this particular image that I am just broadcasting right now, if you can read it, right? So let's look at MotoGP from a very, very different perspective, okay? Let's look at MotoGP as a circus, okay? It's like, how many of you have been to a circus? I don't know. Give me a thumbs up or a wave. How many of you have been to a circus? How many of you have seen circus where there's a set of people who come, try, some are funny, some are daredevils, some perform tricks, some animals, and, you know, there are so much act that goes on, you know. So we all know what a circus is. So let's look at MotoGP as a circus. It's not a sport. It's not, for a moment, think it's not a sport. It's a group of people owned by a company, or hired by people who work for a company, perform for a company, are taken by this company from different parts of the world to different parts of the world, from Europe, to show their talent. And what is their talent? It is their talent of riding a motorcycle fast and competing with each other, right? Now, MotoGP is a circus as a business. So when MotoGP travels from country to country, they have different deals which goes on between, you know, between the organizer of the local nation, wherever this race is performing, and the organizer of the event, which is Dorna, right? So they have different kinds of agreement based on the country and, you know, based on the kind of the package that they build together. But ultimately, the owners of this circus coming to our country, for example, if it has to come to India, there's another company in India which has to take the owners to organize this event, to welcome this circus, saying, hey, you come and perform in my country, I will sell the tickets, I will bring in the crowd, I will do the all the, you know, shushas, and then you will see, you will, you know, perform here, and you know, you get a share out of it. And that's the business style that it works, right? So, but for us, for a person like us, it is just a sport. You know what I mean? It's just a sport, and you know, we enjoy the sport, and we support team, support riders, support individuals, and say, hey, great, this is what I'm supporting for. But at the background, it is a simple, straightforward business that runs, and it is nothing wrong. Okay, so I'm not trying to degrade anything here, but that's what every sport is, and you know, that's what happens in cricket also. If you want to see plain and simple, and that's what the IPL does to itself. That's what EPL does. You know, there is a strong business background to it. If without the business background and the business, without the business economics, the system and the sport is not going to survive. So that's what MotoGP as a circus is. The participants are not just sportsmen. So let's look at them. They are not sportsmen. They are the entertainers and performers who land in different countries to perform racing and to entertain people who are sitting and watching at the venue or on television, who clap their hands when they do a pass, when they go ooh when someone crashes, or you know, some hard moves happen, and then they're you know, they side different teams, and the riders, their favorite riders, they cheer for. So these are basically your entertainers and performers. So if you want to put it in simple act or in simple words, they are your movie stars from your Bollywood or Hollywood or Tollywood, whichever. Each of you, you know, like a particular star, and these are these stars, and they come and do their performance. It's just that they don't have stunt doubles. They do everything by themselves. They get injured. Yeah, that's the crazy part of it, and that's the excitement part of it. Many of us, majority of us, watch race for two things only. You know, why I say this also. Boxing is very popular. Okay, why is boxing popular? Because you side one person and you like to see the other person beat the shit out of this guy, right? And that's what excites people, and that's why boxing became a multi-million-dollar business, and because people were excited to see someone getting hurt. Now, why is MotoGP so famous? MotoGP is famous because nobody knows how it feels to ride a 300 kilo bike at 320 kilometers per hour. Nobody knows what it feels like to pass a motorcycle at 320 kilometers per hour. Brake from 300 to 60. Don't know the feeling, right? So these are unknown factors for a spectator. And that is why a spectator is always too enthusiastic about a motorcycle racing, a motorcycle platform. Number two, if these guys who perform in front of you are like the circus people. They are the people who are, you know, perform tricks, who perform comedy, who perform stunts. You know, these are the kind of people. So imagine the riders as an entertainer, a performer, right? But in truth, like I said in the beginning, I mean, I was supposed to say it later, but I started off with that. It is a multi-million euro business ecosystem in which talents, technicians, marketeers, media personnel, hospitality, taxi drivers, brands, physicians, doctors, physios, you know, airline, cargo companies, so many of them make a living out of it. So see how a business is set up around a sport, and that is why it is a strong business, and that is why it costs money to be part of MotoGP, because without money, the business ecosystem will not exist, right? So motorsports is based on money, or any sport for that matter is based on money. A talent is only one part of it, right? A talent is only one part of it, but everything around it, for the system to roll, for the gears to run in tandem, and you know, to work, for the every person involved into make a living out of it, it involves money, and that's why MotoGP is a multi-million euro business ecosystem which exists in this world. And that is why we think that it is a expensive sport because you need to spend money or you need to pitch in money. You need to have to put in money to be part of this particular sport, right? So I'll go to the next slide now. Slide 2. Okay. So just to give you a quick glimpse of what MotoGP is, right? We all know there is Moto3, which is the 250cc, Moto2, which is the 750cc now. From 600, it's moved to 750, the Triumph engines, and the MotoGP itself, which is the 1000cc. So I need all of you to understand these are all prototype motorcycles, and they're not for road use and not sold in the showrooms. So if you want to even set up a team in MotoGP, you need to identify a manufacturer, you need to work out a proper plan, and you need to procure the required bike and the performance components from various performance components and put a race bike together. Like, for example, why do they say Moto2, there's a Kalex chassis, there's a KTM chassis, there's a speed up chassis, and so on and so forth. So it's not a bike which is made out by one manufacturer for production use. It is made built by the teams with various components which they deem fit for a proper package based on their experience and knowledge, right? So that's what they have put together. So in each of these categories, the engine is supplied by one manufacturer. So Moto3 Honda supplies the engine. The chassis could be by a third party or by Honda itself, which again is modified to suit the rider, to suit the team's performance and handling, and and their technical philosophy. They could have different wheels. Each teams can have different wheels. They might have different brake system. They might have different data loggers. They can have different cams and different components which are small, the levers, and all these can be different. It need not be from one manufacturer or provided by the manufacturer. So please understand that. So this is the bike which is built by the teams to suit a particular rider for a particular environment. So remember, these bikes are, if rider A rides it, it can, and it is set up for rider A. If rider B takes their bike, it's very difficult for the second rider to adapt to this bike. It's completely, very difficult for him. It will be very difficult for him to ride. So that is how precise these bikes are built, and not just, hey, come take a bike and go. Not like you take a bike from a friend and ride. So that's how, precise the sport is. This is how serious the sport is, right? So you can imagine, in order to build a custom bike motorcycle like that for you to race to that level of precision, the cost and the money involved, let alone building a, production bike, how much it costs. I mean, if you're going to buy a 250cc, how much does it cost? And it's a mass production bike. These are prototypes. So the cost of the bike is, you won't be able to put a figure together. If I tell you the figure, it's going to deter you more. But typically a Moto3 bike would cost, if I'm right now, it will be about 23 lakhs, it will be about 23 lakhs Indian rupees. And it's going to be crazy if I have to tell you, go buy a 250 Moto3 bike, And I'm saying a fully built, race spec, ready to roll bike, That's how much it will cost you. And if you want more components, then there's many more and much more. There's one single bike. So if a team has to put two bikes, then they would have to shell out close to 50 lakh rupees. That's the kind of money that one has to spend to get just the bike, and then goes on spares and the rest of the stuff. So that's the MotoGP classes that we're talking of, and I hope you all understood that these are prototype bikes and not for road use, and the cost of these bikes are exorbitant when you compare. So you cannot really compare your Honda 250 or to a NSF 250. It's not going to be a match at all. Not only from the performance, but of course even from the build and the setup itself. Then comes the third slide, which I have put together. I don't know how many of you will be able to see. Let me try. This is the flow which I put together. I'll try to enhance it in the recorded version of it. Right, so I'm going to move it around and show you. So this is going to be fun, right? So let's say, so as I have told you, it is a completely different beast and platform to ride in MotoGP. I have explained that to you, and that is the reason we expect everybody to start this particular racing at a very young age. I mean, that's why predominantly you see most of the riders, and 90% of the riders are from the age group of 6 to 10 is when they start racing in their smaller categories at, you know, at their home grounds, and then they step up to various different categories as they go forward. So that is the amount of time that they need to spend to evolve themselves as a motorcycle racer to get into a very competitive environment as such as MotoGP. I'm telling you, the intensity in a MotoGP paddock is like, you know, it's unbelievable. You know, it's unbelievable. If some of you are in the national championship grid, if you have been there and if you participate in national championship, if you want me to put a the difference, it will be 100x the pressure of what you see in the national championship, x100, you know, and the cost also is x100. So let's take the scenario. Okay, I've put a couple of two, three scenarios, and what is the path to the ultimatum of going to MotoGP. So we presume that someone has to start at the age of 6 to 10. For those of you who are starting later, also is the same path, but it is predominantly one on the right and not on the left. So if you are starting at the age of 6 to 10, let me start scrolling it, moving it around. Okay, so you can go into join a training academy, get yourself trained in an academy with the intention of joining talent cups organized by manufacturers in your local country. So predominantly this was a non-existent factor in those days, but now we have every country has some manufacturers doing some activity to develop a talent in from their local country. So it is very pretty much active. So you can choose to be part of a talent cup organized by a manufacturer. I would say you would have to spend a maximum of 2 years to prove that you know who you are, and not only to the organizers, but also to yourself that you are capable and you are capable of performing and fighting the odds and coming through as a winner. So that is the most important part, you know, to prove it to yourself that you will be able to do it, seeing the challenges which are there in this particular platform, which is very, very naive and which is very, very, the intensity is very low. And at this level of intensity, if you are able to fight and if you are able to prove yourself, then automatically you have an upgrade which happens to the next level. So you're looking at maximum of 2 years. It could happen after one season also if you're very good at it. Even after one season, you will be able to get on to the next level. So which is the next level? The next level would be the talented riders with maximum two to from a country, two or three will be selected for an international series like the ATC or the Red Bull Rookies. You can either apply directly, right, after doing your stint with your, you know, manufacturers or your one-make races, and you can directly look at going for the ATC, that is the Asia Talent Cup or the Red Bull Rookies. These are the prime feeder series or a prime stepstone for anybody who wants to get into a world championship status, that is specifically MotoGP, right? This provides a great platform, and it is being created to incubate talents into MotoGP. MotoGP also needs talent, right? Only if talent comes, they will be able to keep the circus going. If the talents don't come, and if you don't have that kind of talent, what after Rossi, nobody came. It would have been a boring scenario for them to even telecast it, you know, market it and make money out of it, right? So they need to create this platform for talents to incubate talents in each of their platforms for their MotoGP itself. So that is why the Asia Talent Cup and Red Bull is supported by Dorna themselves, and you know, it's an incubation platform where you have an opportunity to go into the first step, stepping stone into the world championship scenario. And that's why part of it is run along with MotoGP, so that you get the understanding and idea of the paddock, the intensity of the paddock, the intensity of the competition, how this whole mechanism works, you know, how the whole system works, right? So then comes, if you perform in that, right? So let me move from left to right to understand. So if you are selected and if you are performing in ATC, after that, if you are not selected, what do you have to do? Okay. So let me go back to this scenario. So you are 6 to 10 years old. You have not been selected a part of, you are not part of a talent hunt or a talent cup in your local country. Then you join your one make races, which could be a different platform altogether. Gain a couple of years experience in that, where you dice and you know you have the option to do at your you know, without spending too much money, and that's why we propose the one make championship. Otherwise, you always have the option to participate in your national championship with your local team by paying. And remember, this whole right hand side platform is about pay and ride, right? You pay and ride in a private team in your local championship, and otherwise you participate in one make races and upgrade yourself to pay and ride in a private team in an international championship. So why it is pay and ride? You know, this question mark. It, like I said before, it does cost a lot of money, right? If you have to buy your own bike, set up your own team, set up your own infrastructure in international platforms, it is going to cost you much, much higher. So that is why you pay a prescribed fee for the rental of bikes, crashes, blah, blah, blah. This is how it is basically, you know, partitioned and, you know, segregated and given to you also. There are various cost factors which are associated. Those are the cost factors that you have to pay and participate in an international races. So it's the ideal way, right? So if you are not selected in ATC, then you need to try and, so if you have done 2 years of ATC or 1 year of ATC, and then you are suddenly saying, I don't have a ride in ATC or Red Bull Rookie Cup next year, then you come here to this part where it says pay and ride in a private team in an international championship, which is possible, which is a possible feeder series to JWC. Okay, so when I see a private team in international championship, which is a possible feeder series to JWC, is something like your Asia Road Racing Championship. For example, in Asia, ARRC has been acting as a great feeder system to the World Championship also, you know, and there have been many riders who have gone up to Moto2 and, you know, also MotoGP. So ARRC is becoming a strong platform and a feeder series into the FIM World Championship. So you can look at participating in various classes at the entry level classes, the AP250 or the underbones to start with, to prepare yourself to go into the World Championship or the Junior World Championship, let me put it that way. So that is what you need to do. So let me come back to the other side now, okay? So perform in the feeder series in first year, right? Which is the ATC or Red Bull, and or maximum of 2 years. Some riders get a chance of a maximum of 2 years to perform in the feeder series. Some will get maybe only 1 year, depending on the performance and the level of performance a rider shows. And if it is a non-performer, then you still want to be part of the World Championship grid. Hold on. Then you need to be ready to pay and ride in a private team in the Junior World Championship in the Moto3 class, you know. And these are all age specific. So remember, the age starts at 6 to 10 is when you started riding. So by the time you reach here, you're about 13, 14, you know. And that is the age factor. 13, 14, 15 is where you're looking at. So like some of the guys who are riding today in the Talent Cup in India also are slightly older only, right? Because they are, by there, some of them are 17, 16, 17, 18. The 16, 17, 18 should already be in the Junior World Championship or the World Championship. That's the level we are talking if you have to be part of this particular grid. Okay, so if you are not selected, right? So if you are not selected in the ATC, from the ATC platform, then you go into pay and ride in the Junior World Championship. Next, if you are performing well in the feeder series, right? If you're performing well in the feeder series, then you get a chance to ride in the JWC Moto 3, that is Junior World Championship Moto 3. Earlier, this was called the Spanish CHEV, CEV Spanish Championship. They used to call the CHEV. Now it is called the Junior World Championship Moto 3. This is the one step below the World Championship. So in terms of technical regulations also, it's almost on par with the World Championship bikes. There are some reductions, but this is the closest you can get to World Championship. If you are a star here, if you are a star in this particular category, right, then you will get a chance to ride in the Moto 3 team. Could possibly give you a free ride, right? You might not get paid, but your performance, your bike and your ride is taken care of, your flights are taken care of, but there might be some money that you need to bring in as a sponsor. So there are multiple deals. Either they will say, okay, you need to bring in X amount of money, I will give you the ride for free. It could be a negotiation like that. But you need to bring in some money for the travel, or you can need to bring in some money for certain equipments. So, or some performance parts, you know, there could be a different kinds of deals that a team can throw at you. But predominantly, if you are a good performer, if you're a star performer, and if the team feels they can take you and make a good run out of you. So why do they take you and give you a free ride? If they can take you and make a good talent out of you, there are brands in Europe which look at associating with these teams, you know. That way, sponsorship activities are much, I wouldn't say easier, but it's more matured, and in the way the interaction and understanding of this particular whole business is much more stronger in Europe and as compared to Asia. The teams are able to raise, you know, decent amount of funds. Some teams work with only sponsorship, so they only take sponsorship. They don't take any money from the rider because they have a good network of sponsors and they derive good benefits for their sponsors based on their performance. So that is the reason they look for star riders. This star rider is going to give performance, and hence the brand which is associated with the team is going to get publicity. That is how they are going to look at. That is why they will give you a free ride. There are teams which absolutely only work on paid ride. I mean, their survival is based, they do get sponsors, but the sponsorship percentage is small. So the money is brought in by the rider. So what do you do if you're a non-performer in the Junior World Championship and you're not taken into any World Champion Moto 3 team? Then you pay and ride in a private team in the World Championship. So this particular platform, for example, see, if you are part of, this could also happen when you are going, for example, a manufacturer is supporting you, and the manufacturer is trying to put you onto a particular team, and that team can only accommodate two riders. I mean, that's the maximum thing that they can handle, you know, riders that they can handle. And so if they are accommodating two riders from the same manufacturer and there is a third star rider, even sometimes that third rider is put into a private team. Of course, the sum is paid by the manufacturer, but it's a pay and ride, you know, it's not the manufacturer's team, right? So the sum is paid to the private team by the manufacturer. So if you're a non-performer, I'll put it the other way. If you're saying you're not up to the mark so that you don't get a ride in Moto 3 in the World Championship, you go pay and ride in the Moto 3 World Championship with a private team, and there are teams that operate like that, right? So there will be a cost to it. Now, how do you pay? There are multiple ways to pay. You can either pay from your own pocket if you have so much money. And if you ask me how much will that cost, just to give you a figure, just to give you an idea, let's keep it at 500,000 euros. That is 5 lakh euros. Okay. You convert it into whatever the currency rate is today. Keep it at 5 lakh euros. Okay, that's how much it will cost you to be part of a Moto 3 grid. So now coming to the Moto 3. Say you got Moto 3 ride, a free ride in a team, and after that what happens? Then you don't perform in that, right? Suppose you ride for Team Asia, right? From, because we are from Asia, you go ride in Team Asia, and you don't perform to their expectations. Then you will not get a Moto 2 seat. So you hence again find funds from your pocket and through raising funds through sponsors to go join the next level upgrade of Moto 2 or to stay back in the Moto 3, right? Moto 3 team. Ketan, it's 5 lakh euros, 500,000 euros. Half a million, you know, right? So you go and pay and ride in a Moto 2 team. So till here is what the payment visibility is clear. You need to continue to pay and you are riding in a Moto 2 team. If you are performing well in the Moto 3 and if you've done very well, fought for the championship, top 5, top 3, and they see you as a good talent. Not only talent, sometimes they look at from a perspective that you are a good talent, but you are not fit enough to in the Moto 3 because of your size, you're growing, because by the time you're finishing your Moto 3 season, you're already approaching your 17th and 18th, right? Say 2 years in Moto 3. As you become 17, 18, your body structure changes, you become bigger, taller, hence Moto 3 might not be an apt bike for you to ride. So teams might decide that to put you move to Moto 2 in a much earlier earlier than they plan to. So if you are getting selected, then you might move to Moto 2 in the team that you are already there, or some other team will get you. So when you move to Moto 2, again, it could be a free ride, or it could be a free ride where you need to take some money for a certain part of it, right? There are some riders who still raise sponsorship and give the money to the team. Or there is a salaried ride. You know, there are some good riders who are selected by the team and they also be paid a salary, right? It might not be substantial, but you know, could be 100,000 euros, you know, like 1 lakh euros. So that will be about 70 lakhs. Yeah, about 70, 75, 80 lakhs per year. I mean, for us, it's big, but you know, if you look at it, there could be a salary option at that point of time. So till this time, seldom, very rarely that you can expect that you will get some earning out of motorcycle racing. You will get, I'll tell you that part of it also, from racing as a salary, okay? But by the time you are getting to this point, you're already a popular guy, which means you have sponsorship association already going on. So, which means you are already striking deals with brands. Maybe you can sign up to deals worth a few hundred thousand dollars, or some good personalities could even have about $1 million deal, you know. So, about 2-3 crores at least you can sign in terms of sponsorship by the time you get to your Moto 3, Moto 2 category. So, that is why some of these guys continue to be there in the grid. Despite putting money, it's like an investment, okay? They will say, okay, I will pay for the ride, and then they will go sell themselves out in the market saying, hey, I'm a MotoGP rider in the world championship. I can give your brand so much visibility. Pay me so much. So they would have invested, say, 5 lakhs. Example, I'm just giving you. If they have invested 5 lakhs, then they will go sell the same package to the sponsor or the brands they associated for 10 lakhs, right? When they do that, they get a 5 lakh straight profit. That is also a business possibility which is available around here. You can look at it from that perspective also. But having said that, if you get a salaried or a free ride, this is the point where your paid ride ends, right? You pay and ride in a private team in the Moto 2 class. If you don't get a world, if you are a great performer in Moto 2, obviously we all know, then you are selected by a MotoGP team. MotoGP teams are classified into two different categories. One is a private team supported by a factory and a factory team, right? A satellite team and a factory team. So typically there are satellite teams because a factory team cannot have all the riders in their kitty, right? So they give it to the satellite team, which is backed by them. And then once they grow to a certain level, then they will move on to the factory team. And that is what is happening, how Jack Miller was with Pramac, and now he's moving into the factory team. So that is the path normally they set for many of the riders. Not now. They set it when they are already in the Moto3 class or they are proving to be champions. They already define, this guy is going to come into my stable. This horse is going to be in my stable. So that is the kind of, vision a team owner or a team manager has to put this thing together. So if you are not getting your MotoGP ride after your Moto2 performance, then obviously you have to stay in Moto2 itself. I'm not going to go into other racing series. I'm just talking about MotoGP this weekend. But as far as that goes, you will stay in the Moto2 class and still as a paid rider or a free ride, bringing in sponsorship and trying to make yourself active and continue to make some money out of racing. So then you do then you raise sponsorship. Like I said, you spend 5 lakhs on racing, keep balance 5 lakhs with you. The 5 lakh which I'm saying is just a normal figure which I'm giving you, a hypothetical figure. It's not a specific figure for anything, just to give you an idea. Okay, so keep the other 5 lakhs with you, and also do other activities like an academy or a training and so on and so forth. There are whatever rest of the time you have, you try to make money out of it. So this is how you start making money as a professional rider when you get to this particular point. And of course, once you sign a MotoGP deal, then the numbers are different, right? The numbers are totally different, and the kind of contracts and the sponsorship and the deals you sign, we all know some of the figures which are out there in the market. Some of it is true, some of it is not, but let's understand one thing. The intensity and the commitment when you start getting money from someone to perform, right? Let this be my sign-off for today. The day you start making money out of motorcycle racing or your passion, right? It is a very thin line where the pressure builds up, right? And where it starts becoming annoying, So you need to start understanding this particular change in the system where when it becomes commercial from a sport, when it becomes tips over to the commercial side of the sport, it becomes very serious. The contracts are very serious. The negotiations are very hard. The non-performance is questioned very badly, very harshly, although you will not be seeing it on the front on television. All those things they say, that great performance and great support and great rider, it's all media and PR aside. However, when they go into the drawing board or in a meeting room, the negotiations and the discussions are very, very hard. It's not very easy. Some teams try to be good to retain good talent. Some teams are very arm twisting. We have seen many cases like that in our national teams itself. We have seen many cases in the world championship. What happened to Jorge, and so if there are rumors of so many kinds, I mean, I'm sure there's something which some unsettled situation that happens, right? So it's a let me sign off by saying that it is a very, very aggressive business, and if you are getting into MotoGP, you are getting into a very, very aggressive sporting business, right? That's what you're getting into. And it's just not about riding a bike fast, posing in front of the press or standing with the bikes and having a good life. No, there's a lot more which all these riders go through, and that is why they need that kind of conditioning, their fitness, their mind, and the salary that they get paid, because they give their lives, they put their lives at risk. And what they go through, the intensity, what they go through is unbelievable. So this is how I decode MotoGP, and this is what I have understood MotoGP is, and that's what I shared with you. I hope this was helpful to you guys. Many of you have requested me to, decode ARRC and World Superbike. World Superbike is not too different from what I have just spoken, but I can talk about it a bit in the next thing. So I will talk about production bike racing in the next episode, which is next Saturday. So I will talk about World Superbike, ARRC, you know, any production class racing, and how someone can build a career out of it, or how can someone be a part of these production racing also. So that's it from me from this side. Any last final questions? You guys have a couple of minutes before I sign off. Hey Yatin, how are you, man? Why are you joining when the show is ending? So this is what MotoGP is all about. If you are pursuing it, good luck. Be persistent, be strong, you know, be disciplined. And, you know, you have to have a strong focus to achieve this particular dream, you know. And there are many sacrifices that you do through your life, you know, to the path to becoming a MotoGP rider. Every rider would say that. And there is many sacrifices that happen, not only from your individual side, but also from your family. So a lot that goes into it. With that, I'm signing off today's episode. Thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed, and I hope all of you are safe and COVID-free. Stay safe. I'll catch you on next Saturday. Hey, before I go, let me show my face once again before I go. I'm sorry. So before I go, let me say that there's going to be something called Paddock Talk between me and Tarun Kumar of CRA Motorsports. It's going to be a good chit chat about sponsorships and advertising in motorsports. We're going to have a kind of debate. I don't know what he's going to ask and what I'm going to speak, but it's going to be very natural. And this is what we want to share with people, saying what the owners or the team managers speak in the paddock, and that's what we're going to do. It's going to be tomorrow 7 p.m. and it's going to be every Sunday. It's going to be called Paddock Talk. So please be ready for that also. Till then, see you guys. Take care. Signing off. Ciao.